And I was going to go into really a lot of the stuff with Joseph Smith and them, but we just don't have time. But just know that they're very closely related and pull and draw things from each other, especially when it comes to their rituals and their ceremonies and the things that they go through. Okay? There are many social aspects of Freemasonry, just like a church would has social aspects to what we do. They have declared themselves to be a social organization that provides men the opportunity to do more. So become better, do more, 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 more. So that's why they focus on education and on worship and on charity. Those are their three main, what they do in their lodges and what they're all about. So their education takes three primary forms: rituals, lectures, and literature. So I'm just going to kind of go through some of the things that they do in the lodges and that kind of conducts. This stuff is publicly known, and then ex-Masons, but we don't know much about their worship or their rituals because those are very secretive. But what the rituals in their education, these are kind of like what they call passion plays. That when if you want to be a Mason, you have to take part in. So they're very much into symbolism, allegory, acting out, being actors. The teachings of ritual deal with issues. So instead of just someone standing up there and lecturing, though they do that too, they will get you involved in mock plays. And so they literally dress up and act things out. Most Grand Lodges then have a monitor that explains the meaning of the Masonic. So they're very much into teaching you about their symbolism, you know, the big eye, the pyramid, it's a very symbolic religion that they spend a lot of time. And they said that even non-Masons are familiar with it, but you can't understand it unless you go through their rituals and go through their whole teachings. Another way to think of it is their dramas. They play act these dramas, and that's how they teach the rituals. Oops, I don't want to do that. So then their lectures, they provide education on a variety of topics that talk about morals and spiritual teachings of Freemasonry. So at each of their lodge meetings, they'll always have lectures, and they'll teach you more about the depth of Freemasonry. A lot of it's conducted in the form of questions and answers. They're very high with memory work, which is interesting, since Christians do not like to be told you should memorize scripture. Masons have to memorize everything for their degree. To move up degrees, you have to have things completely memorized, and then they'll test you. So for an example, for that first one, and to get to be an entered apprentice, the question will come, what covering has a lodge? The answer that they have to give by memory is a clouded canopy or star-decked heaven where all good Masons hope at last to arrive. By the aid of that theological ladder which Jacob in his vision saw ascending from earth to heaven, the three principal rounds of which are denominated faith, hope, and charity, and which admonish us to have faith in God, hope in immortality, and charity to all mankind. They don't get to read that. They have to. So that's that's something they have to put into memory so that they own it. So that's what they believe. I read some of these, and I'm just astonished that educated people say, okay. And if I went into what they actually have to dress like when they do this stuff. I'll give you an example. To get into the first one, they have to completely strip and take all metal off, no rings, including their wedding ring, and then they have to put on these other clothes that the lodge provides them. Then they have to have the left breast open so that they can make sure it's a male and not a female. They have to have the right leg rolled up. They're blindfolded, so. And they call the ritual a hoodwink. They go through a hoodwinking. And then they're put a noose around the neck and they're led around. That's the drama. It's very difficult for me to see grown men doing this, but they do. It's just bizarre. In my mind, it's bizarre. Hopefully in your mind, it's bizarre. But they do it. And you have to do it. It's not a choice. Anyways, the lectures prepare them for the rituals, so they're all intertwined. Education is very, very important to them. Masons are admonished in their rituals to hope for eternal life. The Muslim, Hindu, and Mormon Masons are encouraged to hope that they too will go to heaven, even if they don't have faith in Jesus Christ. That's not, so we can see where the lodge is very centered around talking about eternity. And you can get there no matter what you believe, as long as you believe in a supreme being. Their literature, they have numerous books available to the Master Mason, so you have to get to the third degree before you really get into the deeper things of the craft, is what they call it. And if you were to look at some of the books, they're Luciferian or satanic in nature. However, they don't talk about Lucifer or Satan, and they don't talk about Jesus. But that doesn't mean that that's not what they're referring to. Because they use so much symbolism and allegory, they kind of can come around and talk about things without actually saying it, which apparently is more attractive to people. Their worship, which also happens at their lodge meetings. They pray. Like I said, they always open and close in prayer. And then during their worship times, they do take these secret oaths and go through the rituals, which are dramatic presentations. So that all happens there. And then the third thing I said they do is charity. And they have public charity, which now all of their charity is directed toward primarily Masonic recipients, first and foremost. So even if you're the child of a Mason, you're going to get preferential treatment at the Shriners Hospital. Okay, that's just how it is. Obviously, the most well-known, most everybody knows about Shriners Hospitals. They provide medical services, including surgery to children, most often without charge. So they're very wealthy. Masons are generally very wealthy, and we'll share why that happens. Much money, though, is raised from the public to support the hospitals because we all have the soft heart and think we need to give money to anybody who's helping children, it seems. I'm not going to go into a great deal. Everybody knows you can't believe everything you read on the internet. I did a lot of research on this. There are innumerable articles and reports showing that the IRS has indeed done audits on Shriners Hospitals. But there was specifically a series of investigative report and articles in the Orlando Sentinel back in 1986, because obviously people question, how can a hospital provide, services free of charge? How much money are they making? And they found out that the IRS audits, at least, like I said, I can't 100% guarantee this is true, so take it for what it's worth. And I did find it in several different places, but less than a third of the millions of dollars raised actually goes to the hospital. Most of it goes back into, and actually, they raise money for the Shriners Hospitals through the circus, through football games, newspaper sales. They're like all over. The rest is kept for the temples and the Masonic homes and these other places. And if you have seen some of the Masonic homes, they very much look like some of the Mormon tabernacles and temples. They're very, very fancy. They have these conventions. Shriners have a lot of parties, celebrations, commemorations, rituals, things that require a lot of money. So that's their main public one. Then they do have private charities, which primarily revolve around their Masonic homes. Again, if you Google, you'll find many fraternal Masonic organizations and services that are offered free of charge for Masons. They have children's homes, senior living homes, nursing homes, all sorts of things. With children, the children's homes, they very often take children away from their families, even if you're a Mason. They believe that they provide a family atmosphere and they don't trust putting them back into those homes. So some of the children's homes, they get around the red tape somehow, well, I can tell you how they get around the red tape, because most, not most, many politicians and businessmen are Masons, and they take an oath to be faithful and to defend each other, and then it's silent because you can't give it up. So that's why you see all this money floating around, and all. I tend to avoid the term conspiracy theory, but there's some conspiracy going on, undoubtedly, with Freemasonry. There's no doubt about that. In the this particular picture that I have up is in Maryland. You can see the, if you look closely, you could see in the middle the main symbol for Freemasonry. At senior living homes, they are offered first to Masons. And most of the stuff is offered very low cost or free of charge. I was reading on one Masonic senior living site right here in Minneapolis, and they're very bold to say that the difference between Masonic senior housing and other private senior housing providers is their association with Freemasonry. And then they expound on all the famous people who are Masons and the history of Masons and how Masons are only open to men of good character and men who believe in a supreme being and men who are between the ages of 18 and 25, that you have to be between those ages to get in, apparently, depending on the jurisdiction. Then they go into great deal about the supreme being can be God, Buddha, or whoever you hold in that position. As a Christian, how can you... How could you even consider living in one of these homes when that's just put right out there on the home page? They're not even hiding who they are. Masons come from many religious traditions. They're very proud of this, including Christianity, Buddhism, Sikhism, Islam, Judaism, and Hinduism, right on the front page. And then they finish by saying what ranks of Masonry are permitted as preferential treatment, which relatives are allowed in. Obviously, also that you'll become a Mason so that you can enjoy this lifestyle at some point in your life. Okay, so charity, yes, but understand there's motives behind the charity to provide for their own. The last core belief of Christianity is that Christ will bring his kingdom in glory. Now, again, there's kind of a representation of part of the hoodwinking, but we'll talk more about that. Freemasonry doesn't speak of Jesus Christ, as I've said. It does speak about salvation from hell. It talks about good works a lot, which is why they do so much charitable stuff and show up at all kinds of parades and whatnot. They're trying to show themselves as being good people. The activities, the things that they do, some of them are very good. We know that to be true. But those things don't deliver them from hell. And yet that's the teaching of Freemasonry. This particular picture I put up is one of their big, like I said, every Mason gets through the third degree. That's kind of funny. Didn't think of that. But they're encouraged to act out a myth. And this is the acting out of Hiram Abiff. And every Mason who wants to be into the third degree has to go through this ritual. And it's really where this person, Hiram Abiff, was unjustly murdered, buried, and raised from the grave. Catch the symbolism there. And as they act out this ritual, they're suggesting that immortality happens through this legend. So when you go through this, you actually are proving to yourself that you're immortal. So that's what they're teaching in this legend. After the ritual is acted out, then they remove the blindfold from your eyes. And I mean, actually it's all done in darkness anyways, but then there's a light in the lodge above the master's chair. So remember, there's always a worshipful master. He sits on the east side of the lodge, and then there's a light above his chair. And so after an initiate is what they call them, after they go through this acting out of this legend, and it's said that they're beat and that things happen, but I won't go there. After that, then the blindfold is taken off. They're told to look at this light. And then they say, the light of a master mason is darkness visible. Basically, they're telling them you'll always be able to see if you look at the light of the worshipful master. So kind of creepy, I think, but it is what it is. It's a pagan ritual that they have to go through. And their whole point is to get them to see that they can gain this light and that they can gain immortality, which makes them, and that's why you have to join them to find out more about how that happens, apparently. Clearly in contrast to biblical Christianity. So what do we do with this? If you've heard from any Freemasons that got out, they would tell you, if you're in it, get out and repent of all involvement. It's very important that you not stay part of it in any way, shape, or form. There's actually many, many prayers of release from the curses, generational curses, because these men take oaths that bind their families and whatnot to the satanic realm. And so very important to get out. It's also important, they say, don't support the Masons in any way, because you might think you're supporting something good, but you're cohorting with the enemy. Don't pray with them. They said, please don't pray with them, pray for them. And then they said, if you know anybody who's in Freemasonry, study up. And I would suggest you get in tune with biblical Christianity and then have the talk, because it's very dangerous. I'm just telling you, it's very dangerous. I could say it's more dangerous than the other religions I've talked about, but it is very, very dangerous. Probably, I feel like more dangerous, because they suggest that you can be Christian and be a Freemason at the same time. I want to finish up. I thought of reading one of the hundreds of testimonies that I looked at online and in print. But I chose instead, I was very, how many people know of Charles Finney? I know you do. We have several books from him. He was a revivalist back in the 1830s, about. He's written some amazing books about God, on revival, just an amazing man of God. We're especially drawn to some of the old timers, because they just spoke truth so boldly. Well, Charles Finney was, God actually used him to bring revival in America, very powerful revival. He's said to have over 500,000 converts to Christianity from other, like, this isn't from Lutheranism to, you know, something else. This is unbelievers who came to know Jesus Christ. Interestingly, he was also a Freemason. That is until he met Jesus. He experienced actually a dramatic conversion to Christianity. It's very fun to read what happened to him. But he, at the time, he didn't realize, he had been in Freemasonry for about 4 years, and he didn't realize that it was evil. But soon after he came to faith in Christ, he had a lodge meeting. So he went to the lodge meeting, and he was asked to open and close in prayer, which he did in Jesus' name, because now he was a Christian. And he said, as soon as he closed the prayer, something, Holy Spirit came on him, and he realized at that moment he couldn't have anything to do with the lodge or anything that it represented. And he, in fact, after that, and that only meeting that he went to after coming to know Jesus, he said he experienced, everything he experienced at the lodge was monstrously profane and barbarous. But he had been blinded to it before that. He was alarmed, he said, at his own ignorance to how much had been imposed on him by Masonry. And as he prayed, he said, Holy Spirit took him into a time of reflection and examination and earnest prayer. He knew he had to leave Freemasonry behind, and his he said his new life in Christ instinctively and irresistibly recoiled him from having any fellowship with what the Lord revealed to him as unfruitful works of darkness. But when he left, he chose to just be quiet. He chose not to tell anybody about it. He just chose to walk away from it and never, he prayed. He said he rebuked all the oaths. He had taken many oaths to be in allegiance to the Freemasons. He broke those all. He said he felt they were all null and void, and he would not allow himself to be known as a Freemason anymore. Then he said a few years later, there was a book published, and you can go and find this book on the internet. And it was revealed to him, or to the world, actually, at that point, Secret Revelations, first book ever written that revealed Secret Revelations of Freemasonry. It was written by Captain William Morgan. Interestingly, our son-in-law's name is William Morgan. Billy's name is literally William. So anyways, Captain William Morgan was a former Mason. And when God got a hold of him, he decided to expose completely what happened in Freemasonry. When that book came out, the church, the Big C Church, took a strong stand against Freemasonry because they believed what he said. Now, I will add to you that you can look up Captain William Morgan and you'll see this. He was, Morgan, when he first announced his intention to publish this book, he was arrested on trumped up charges. And then he disappeared soon after. He's believed to have been kidnapped and killed by Masons from Western New York. He's never been, his body was never found. No one, they just believe this is what happened. Again, the cover-up is incredible. And you can read all about it if you want to. Anyways, as a result of the public uproar over the abduction and presumed murder of Captain Morgan, and everyone knew that this had to be a Freemason thing because he was exposing it, and the firm stand of the church against it. A majority of Masons renounced, and 3/4 of the Masonic lodges at that time closed for the lack of membership. So there was a real revival came, and Charles Finney was part of that revival. Okay, but what happened was after people read Morgan's book, they started coming to Charles Finney because they knew that he was a Freemason. So they said, is it true? Is the book true? Because I'm sure the revelations were alarming. And he read the book and he confirmed that it was verbatim revelation of the first 3 degrees that he had taken himself. And what happened was that caused him to decide he couldn't be silent anymore. He needed to speak out. And in fact, wrote this book himself about Freemasonry, exposing it and telling other people that they needed to renounce the horrid oaths that they had taken. Charles Finney went a long ways. He pronounced Freemasonry as an unchristian institution, false religion, and he said that it's immoral. They take oaths to secrecy. They force men to pledge to unlawful things, such as concealing crimes of other Masons. They take an oath to conceal crimes. They take an oath to get Masons out of trouble, even if they're wrong, to protect them if they murder people. They commit to favor Masonry in political action and business matters. You take a pledge of allegiance to support any Mason in political office or in the business world. If they're a Mason, you're with them. Right or wrong does not matter. All that matters is that you're in the Brotherhood. He said that they took oaths. They swore to retaliate and persecute violators of Masonic obligations. So if you said you would do this and you don't, many of their rituals have very symbolic things, like their handshake has something to do, and they do this, which means if you expose, you'll have your throat cut from ear to ear. It goes much farther than that. Burned bodies, torture, being disemboweled, all sorts of things that when you read, then the Masons have defended themselves saying, well, we don't really mean we would do that. We're just trying to, in their rituals and in their initiations, they actually have to say, by penalty, I will allow they allow themselves to be ripped open and my innards to be revealed. They have to actually say that. And then they say, well, we wouldn't really do that. We just want the initiate to know how serious their vows are. So All of this is what Charles Finney continued and said was true, and what they are forced. They're forced to take profane oaths. They're forced to take the name of God in vain. They're forced to teach false and profane things. They're forced to conduct ceremonies and rituals that they don't want to take necessarily. And they refuse all examination and accountability. So Charles Finney was a great spokesman against and to get people set free from Freemasonry. In this book, how I want to end this with this quote that he says. He said, "Surely if Masons really understood what Masonry is, as it is delineated in these books, Freemasonry, and in the book that William Morgan wrote, no Christian Mason would think himself to remain at liberty to remain another day a member of the fraternity. It is as plain as possible that a man, knowing what it is and embracing it in his heart, cannot be a Christian man. To say he can is to belie the very nature of Christianity." So he became quite a spokesman for ex-Masons way back then. So understand that the people have been coming against Freemasonry since 1830. And yet they've made a comeback. And as of late, they say their numbers are down again because, just like in churches, the membership is getting old. And the young guys are not necessarily wanting to do some of the things that they're demanding that they do. So they're either going to have to change some of their rituals or ceremonies, or possibly, hopefully, die as a fraternal organization. But so to wrap it up, Freemasonry is a dangerous false religion, and it masks itself in secrecy and good works. And I will tell you, they do speak generational curses over families, and they keep them bound to the works of darkness. So a lot of people stay in it because they're afraid that those curses will come on their families if they don't stay faithful to the brotherhood. So they feel trapped. And so we can't be ignorant to the inherent danger of such a thing and be there to help them and break those curses. Do you have anything you want to add? He knows actually much more about Freemasonry than me.
Well, but there are just a number of things that you, I mean, you've covered a lot of them. There are always things that seem somewhat funny to me. As a Freemason, you can, because it's only men, you can have sex with any woman you want, as long as it's not, she doesn't belong to a Freemason.
Tony, have you turned it off?